My friends, I have in my hand reports from our scouts near the Everwood Forest. These reports tell us that a massive army is building there, an army of elves. It is my duty now to ask the Senate to authorize the Army of the Republic to march to the south, so we may meet this gathering force and dissuade it from moving toward our cities. I hope you will see the wisdom in my words. I hope you will realize the peril this foreign army represents. This is not a time for posturing. This is a time when we must protect our cities and fellow citizens. Vote as you will.
She still did not know what she was dealing with. She had no friends there. They viewed her as a foolish old woman who was in far over her head. There were plans to remove her, and there were at least 3 attempts on her life. The reason they failed was because she wasn't like them. She didn't think like them. Provided her a kind of armor, protected her. She was one of them. I don't think she would have survived the first year.
As president of the Senate, Amelia Crow had the authority to call a vote to summon the Army of the Republic. And when she raised the issue, no senator dared vote against it. Public opinion of the Senate was at an all-time low. Many cities had drafted writs of no confidence. Summoning the army was a way for the senators to buy themselves time.
When word reached the barracks, we all shouted out, "Long live the Republic!" Jenny Grazer grabbed the colors and held them high. They weren't sending farmers this time. This time, they were sending us. Skansen Rue.
Skansen Rue was a corporal in the Army of the Republic. He served in the 13th Legion, along with 99 other men. His legion was broken into 20-man squads, 5 squads, 100 men to a legion. He was a veteran of the winter battles 3 years before. The leader of his division was Lieutenant Oliver Trask, a man known more for his drinking than his leadership skills. But he was also admired by his men for his fearlessness. Skansen Rue said of his lieutenant, "When Trask empties a bottle, he leaves his fear inside." Trask's division was one of the 20 legions that made up the 5th Regiment. The Army of the Republic had 20 regiments, each with 20,000 men.
"Dear Father, we walked 10,000 steps today. At least that's what the drill instructor told us. 10,000 steps a day, he said. And soon enough, it'll feel like walking across the street. I'm not so sure of that."
Rather than face his father, Bandy Tom signed up as a private in the Army of the Republic. The Army needed men, and so, still not fully trained, he served in the supply train following the Army. The man responsible for Bandy Tom's training was Sergeant Varen Diggs, an old warhorse who had been training young soldiers for 30 years. He had a reputation for drinking and smoking to excess. He also had a reputation for turning out the best soldiers. Diggs also went with his trainees into battle, continuing their training.
"It isn't my job to keep you alive. You're all going to die. It's my job to teach you how to die like men. Take at least 10 bastards with you when you go. Sergeant Varen Diggs."
The standard age of a soldier entering the military was 12. From that early age, he trained for years to learn the art of warfare. Most soldiers were orphans. Their families lost to disease or disaster, they enlisted for 3 square meals a day, a warm bed, and clean clothes. Bandy Tom was 18 when he joined. He thought he would be turned away for being too old.
"There are so many of us that we have our own division. We're called the old men. All of us who joined in late. Our sergeant told us that he didn't have time to train us, and we would have to stand in the front to catch arrows for the trained men. I hope that he's joking, but I don't think he is."
Each soldier served for over 6 months of rigorous training. 14-hour days were typical. Movement was key. When finished with their training, each legion could turn and march and turn again upon a single command. It could walk under fire and not flinch. The men who joined the army ceased being men. They were soldiers. capable of acts men could not even dream of.
When you asked a soldier from the army who he was, he would tell you his legion's name first. They would drop their family names and adopt the legion's name as their own. That's what kind of men we're talking about. Their families were not their families any longer. The legion was their family. These were their brothers. Brothers they fought with, bled with, died for. They weren't men anymore. They were soldiers. And that is a different creature altogether. Tommen knew that, and that's why she knew the elves needed an army of their own. She knew what was coming for them.
They were trained to use the spear and the shield. They knew how to guard each other. When they marched forward with their shields locked, it was with the strength of all the men behind them, pushing. A soldier knew that the man beside him, his shield brother, would protect him just as he knew that he would protect the man beside him. The front ranks of the army could attack as a single unit. To keep the front rank fresh, the Legion rotated men in and out, all the while protecting their brothers.
Watching the two armies would have been like watching two philosophies clash in a physical battle. On the human side, you have a great machine. All the men make up parts of the machine. There are redundancies to cover for failure. One part of the machine comes damaged, it's instantly replaced. Like fighting against a wall. How do you do that? The elves would have to learn how.
It seemed the right thing to do. My friends told me that I must have hit my head at Knot Creek and gone soft, but it was better than going home. I'm serving food in the chow line, and I hear the soldiers talking. They say that the elves are all cowards who will run when they see our shields and spears. I remember talking like that when we marched out to Knot Creek.